I've just had a really good lesson with 10b3.
Buzzing.
Bribing. So we did a little video clip of David Attenborough showing like competition and plants, and I got to answer two exam questions on competition and plants. Then we did a video of animals.
Ow. Morning, guys. Funny. I want you to see me from two angles today. How exciting. We're on, good to see you. Give it another couple of minutes, guys, then we'll get started. Okay, then. To go here. All right, so I turn off that camera. Right, guys, welcome to your second year 11 masterclass. For A-level chemistry. Like I say, last week I watched back some of the footage. I'm like, we got through quite a lot last week, talking about the atomic structure, and then moving on to looking at how the electrons are arranged in subshells rather than just discrete energy levels. So I hope you found it quite interesting. Like you say, though, if you didn't understand it, do not worry, because we'd reteach it anyway at the start of year 12. So again, very much like I'm going through today, the first half of it is going to be looking at, it's a bit of a GCSE recap about bonding, and then we're going to look at a new bit of learning as well. So it gives you a bit of a taster or a flavor as to what we're going to be doing this year. So to remind ourselves, okay, at GCSE, we'll look at the nature of bonding. And the reason why things bond is to have a full outer shell. We tend to call that a noble gas configuration. So noble gases are the ones on the far right of the periodic table. You know, you've got your helium, neon, argon, krypton, radon, and xenon. And they don't react with anything because they have a full outer shell. Most things on the periodic table, therefore, don't have a full outer shell and therefore bond readily with other things. So there are three types of bonding. All right, there are three types of bonding which we need to be aware of. One is ionic bonds, so between a metal and a non-metal, like sodium chloride. Covalent bonds, which occurs between two non-metals, so iodine, methane, water, carbon dioxide, ammonia, anything where you've got two non-metals together, you'll get covalent bonding. A metallic bond, which occurs in metals. So just be aware, most students tend to get the idea that an ionic bond is between a metal and a non-metal, and then a covalent bond is between two non-metals. A metallic bond is a bonding within a metal. It's not two metals bonded together, because they wouldn't bond together, they'd mix together and make something called an alloy. All right, so we'll look at all three bondings together and then move on. So let's just restart this animation. So how are ionic bonds formed? So metal atoms, all right, so the metals are on the left of the periodic table, want to lose electrons. So if we have a look at this sodium atom here, yep, GCSE, still pretty much true to this day. So we know it's from GCSE as being 281. So it's got 11 electrons, 281. Now just watch what happens to the charge again. So as an atom, just going to pause it there, can we see that the number of protons, which are positively charged, and the number of electrons, which are negatively charged, are the same. Therefore, plus 11, minus 11, there's no overall charge. An atom has no overall charge because the number of protons equals the number of electrons. That's a bit of a recap from last week. And then watch what happens is to achieve a noble gas configuration or to achieve a full outer shell, this atom needs to lose that electron there. It can either lose that one or gain another seven. Then we fill the entire third shell there, but which is more likely, right? Metals lose electrons to become positively charged. So watch what happens. That electron that's glowing orange is flying away. We'll discuss where it goes in a moment. And now look, now you've got 11 positively charged protons because you've not done anything to the nucleus, but now you've got 10 negatively charged electrons. So it's plus 11, minus 11, minus 10, apologies, is plus one. Okay, now obviously if they did this, they need something to mop up those electrons. You can't just have metals spitting electrons out into the atmosphere, so something else must bond with it. So the metal loses electrons, the non-metal gains it. So here's chlorine, for example. Notice that is a chlorine atom. All right, the language I'm using is very, very specific there. Chlorine. It's got 287, it's got 17 electrons, so 7 electrons is an outer shell, it's in group 7. And you'll notice again the charge is 0. Plus 17 for the protons, minus 17 for the electrons. Overall, no charge. An atom has no overall charge. And then that electron that was spat out by the sodium on the previous slide has been fed to the chlorine and it's become a negatively charged ion. Now, when the non-metals gain an electron, their name changes slightly. So a chlorine atom, all right, has become a chloride ion. So again, that is a chlorine atom. And then when it picks up an electron, becomes negatively charged, it's a chloride ion. All right, and that's true for any non-metal. So an oxygen atom will gain electrons to become an oxide ion. A sulfur atom will gain electrons to become a sulfide ion. So you notice the terminology. If it ends in "-ide", then it's usually just a non-metal which has gained electrons. So nitride, for example, is a nitrogen atom which has gained electrons. Carbide is a carbon atom which has gained electrons. Okay. And then we end up with this thing here, which you would have seen. Sodium atom donating electron to the chlorine atom to become sodium ion, which is positively charged, and a chloride ion, which is negatively charged. And there's some dot and cross diagrams to have a go at later in the activity in this masterclass. And that's what the ionic bond is. It's the bonding between a positive and negative ion. And in reality, in an ionic lattice, you've got millions of these things in a giant three-dimensional structure. And don't forget that, you know, there's atoms and ions are really, 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 really small. So even in like a grain of salt, which is what sodium chloride is, there are millions and millions and millions of sodium ions and chloride ions all packed together. And the bonding is very strong, which is why they tend to have high melting points. But I don't want to go into too much of that detail today. So that is ionic bonding. All right. Okay. And just this is like a bit of a, it's a nice thing to do with your periodic table. I know that my students would have done this if you had a periodic table in an exam, is that when you get a periodic table, the group number along the top, all right, you can actually work out what the charge on the ion is. So if it's in group one or group two or group three, then it will lose one, two, or three electrons to become a plus one, plus two, plus three, because the metals want to lose electrons. And then the opposite end, five, six, seven, all right, they want to gain electrons. So if it's in group five, it's got five electrons in its outer shell, so it needs to gain three and become a three minus ion, such as nitride. So oxygen gains is in group six, it gains two electrons to become oxide. Fluorine's in group seven, so it gains one to become fluoride. All right, so a little bit of information there for you. Okay, so again, if we think about the ionic compound as a three-dimensional structure, it's not just pairs of sodium ions. Look, they're built up in a giant, regular repeating lattice, a bit like a wall. You know, you build a wall, you put the bricks in a certain order, very similar to this, okay? And you'll notice that each sodium ion is not just attracted to its neighbor, it's attracted to its neighbors. So it's got, you know, it's a three-dimensional attraction. And because it's three-dimensional, there'll be someone going in front of the screen and some behind. So if we build this lattice up, look, yep, can we see that? So you've got all those sodium ions, all those chloride ions packed tightly together. Okay, ta-da. And it's a plus one ion with a minus one ion, so they match up beautifully. Right, covalent bonds then. So ionic bonds are all about metals donating electrons to non-metals, so they have a full outer shell. Covalent bonds are about sharing, because these are two non-metals. All right, so let's just have a look here. So you see that? They share electrons. So watch that again. They share electrons to have a full outer shell. All right, and this happens between two non-metals. Okay, all right. And all it is overlapping of their electron shells. Okay, so again, go back to GCSE, you've seen this before, this diagram. They share, they overlap of electron shells, and they share an area, there's an area where they share electrons, okay, and we call that the covalent bond. All right, so if we have a look here, we've got two hydrogen atoms, so that's the hydrogen nucleus in red, that's the second hydrogen nucleus in red. The blue cloud, if you like, is its electron density, or it's, you know, it's one and only shell, and they've overlapped that, okay? Superb, and you end up with a covalent bond, all right? And there it is, that's all the covalent bond is, all right? Any bond, really, is the attraction between the nucleus of an atom and its electrons, its outer shell, okay? So you can see here, there's my hydrogen atom on the left, there's my other hydrogen atom on the right, and can you see that double orange arrow there and there? That's basically the attraction which is holding, all right, the electrons in place, and we call that a bond, okay? Because don't forget, atoms are 99.999% empty space, okay? So, but you can't obviously put your hand through atoms because the bonds are in the way. So when you touch yourself, you actually feel it, or touch a table, you are feeling the bonds between atoms, all right? And you can get multiple bonds as well. So you can get double covalent bonds, triple covalent bonds. So let's have a look here at carbon dioxide. So can you see there, a bit difficult to see on your diagram, but you see there's four electrons there. Four electrons there. And then on this side, four electrons there. So that is not a single covalent bond. That is a double covalent bond. So we represent them with lines here. So you can see that long equal sign represents a double covalent bond, which means it is two pairs of electrons being shared, and similar there. Oxygen, again, oxygen's in group six, so each of these oxygen atoms wants to gain two electrons. So what they do is they share two pairs, so you end up with an oxygen molecule. Yeah. And nitrogen, actually, because it's in group five, each one wants to gain three, so you end up with a triple bond. So you can get single covalent bonds, double covalent bonds, and triple covalent bonds. And you can draw dot and cross diagrams to show them. Okay. Right. First bit of new learning then, okay? I'm going to sort of like talk to you about this thing here, which are coordinate bonds, all right? And what is a coordinate bond? Well, a coordinate bond, effectively, all right? So here we've got an ammonia molecule and a hydrogen ion, okay? Now think, let's just think in terms of chemistry. If it's a positively charged ion, it has lost an electron. So that's hydrogen, which has lost an electron. So it's got an empty shell because hydrogen's only got one electron and it's given it away. So that's an empty shell. Oh no, I need to gain two electrons, all right? Well, if we have a look at the ammonia, yeah, can we see ammonia has something called a lone pair, all right? So if I did a dot and cross diagram like this, so they're sharing electrons there. Can we see that? That's a covalent bond. They're sharing electrons there. That's a covalent bond. And they're sharing electrons there at the bottom. That's a covalent bond. And then to stabilize it, there are two electrons spare. And we call that a lone pair. So again, if you want to distinguish between the two pairs of electrons, we'd call this these ones here involved in the bonding. So that one, that pair, that pair, that pair, we call bonding pairs because they're involved in bonding. And any electrons that are left over, we call lone pairs. Okay, so let's have a look at these two things together. All right. And that's what they look like. Okay, so can we see the hydrogen has an empty orbital, the nitrogen has got a lone pair, all right? And hopefully you can see that they can just match up. They can still share electrons. Even though hydrogen hasn't got any, they can still share electrons if the nitrogen donates both of them. So if the nitrogen was to donate that to that, so you see this sort of ellipse there, if those two electrons were to plant there, the hydrogen has then gained two electrons, hasn't it, really, which is sharing, all right? So it can still form covalent bonds. So if we have a look here, et voila, okay? And the whole thing becomes positively charged, all right? Because if these two things together at the start, so there's no charge there, because that's stable, this one has a positive charge, if we bring them together, the positive charge is still going to be there. Okay, so let's watch this. But now, rather than the hydrogen being positively charged, it's the entire species, all right? This entire chemical here, or ion, I'll say, is positively charged. Because the nitrogen, technically, so can you see the difference? That covalent bond there has got two crosses. Can we see that? That covalent bond there has got a dot and a cross. So the difference between that one and that one is that up here, each atom, i.e. the hydrogen and the nitrogen, has donated one electron each to the bond. Whereas for this one here, on the left-hand side, both electrons are crosses, which means it comes from the same atom. So it's still a covalent bond, it's still a shared pair of electrons, but both electrons in the covalent bond have come from the same atom, which in this case is the nitrogen, all right? And we sometimes differentiate between them. So rather than just drawing them all as just lines between letters, okay, we sometimes represent them as an arrow to sort of show, all right, that you understand that the bond there on the left, pointing to hydrogen, is coordinate. It's called a coordinate bond, or sometimes called a dative covalent bond. So a coordinate bond is where both electrons come from the same atom. The other covalent bonds, can you see the other ones without arrows on them? Yep, those ones there. All right, they're just your standard shared pair of electrons. One electron's being shared by the H, one electron's being shared by the nitrogen to achieve a full outer shell. So that's something brand new for you just to get your teeth into with regards to bonding. So it's just basically, it's the same strength. All right, all these bonds here are the same strength, okay? But because they're all nitrogen hydrogen bonds, but this one here, all right, is a different type of bond in terms, a slightly different type of bond because it is a coordinate bond, i.e. both electrons come from the same source. Okay, so examples where this happens, all right, so we've already looked at the NH4 plus. So can we see here that water, which is H2O, has a lone pair on it, which it can donate to a hydrogen ion, all right, very much like ammonia did. Let's look at, this one here, okay. So can we see here, the whole thing is a 2- ion, but these two, the ones on the left and the one on the right, they're both shared pairs of electrons, they're your standard covalent bonds. but these two from the top and the bottom are still shared pairs of electrons, but they've been donated by chloride ions. All right, so it happens quite a bit in chemistry. I won't do the true and false. And the last type of bond, which is metallic bonding. Again, this happens within metals. So it's not between two metals, it happens within metals, which is very, very exciting. So let's have a look. So this is an aluminium atom, so a sample of aluminium. So can you say that each aluminium has three electrons in its outer shell? One, two, three. One, two, three. All right, now is it stable like that? Of course it's not. It needs a full outer shell to become stable. So what do they do? Well, bear in mind that metals want to lose electrons. All right, it can't just lose electrons to each other. So what it does is it delocalizes its outer shell. So just watch this here. So the outer shell electrons, those little blue dots, have been delocalized. Yep, i.e. they are no longer localized to individual atoms. All right, so they were aluminium atoms. They've just lost electrons to become aluminium ions, which have a 3+ charge. Okay, now in reality, are those electrons just hovering around each ion? No, they're mobile, they can move. Okay, but there's the metallic bond, look, between the positively charged ion and the delocalized electrons. If you just go back one image, can you see wherever there is something positive and wherever there is a blue dot, there is an attraction. So in a metal, there are actually hundreds and thousands and millions and billions of these bonds. Which is why they have high melting points, because you need to break them, which requires a lot of energy. All right, jobs are good. Ta-da. Okay, so what factors affect the strength of metallic bonding, I hear you ask? Well, it's the charge on the ions. So a 3+ ion has a higher charge than a 2+ ion. The size of the ions, so the smaller they are, the better it is at attracting electrons. All right. So if we have a look here, look, we've got three different metals there. We've got sodium, magnesium, aluminium. Sodium's in group one, so it forms a 1+ ion. Magnesium's in group two, so it forms a 2+ ion. Aluminium's in group three, so it forms a 3+ ion. And you'll notice that the charge, as the charge on the metal ion goes up, the melting point of the metal also goes up. So bond strength is linked to charge on the ion. Right, let's look at the size of the ions. So now we're going down group one. So all of these are, all right, just turn the lights back off. Yeah, superb. So these are your group one alkali metals. And they, so they're all a plus one ion. So we're keeping the charge the same now. We're just changing, all right, the ionic radius. Okay, so the radius from the nucleus to the outer shell. Now, do you notice, as we go down group one, from lithium to sodium to potassium to rubidium to cesium, that the size of the ion gets bigger, all right? What effect does that have on melting point, I hear you ask? The melting points decrease. So as the atoms get bigger, the melting point decreases because the bonding gets weaker. Why is the bonding getting weaker? Because there is a greater distance between the nucleus. So if we go back a couple of slides, all right, there's a greater distance between the nucleus and the delocalized electron. So as these gray circles get bigger, the attraction to the little blue dots, all right, the delocalized electrons, gets weaker, all right, as proven by this table here. Okay. Right. Beautiful. So last little bit then we're going to move on to, we're going to start talking about bond polarity. Okay, so what is bond polarity? Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop sharing that screen. Just give me a second. Yep. Beautiful. Yeah. Wonderful. And then let's start sharing this one here. Okay. Right. Bear with me one second, folks, while I just download that PowerPoint. So again, this is a bit of new learning. There's a nice definition that we need to know about. So I'll make sure I go through that in a bit more detail for you. And it's about looking at superb. So ionic bonding and covalent bonding are just opposite ends of the same spectrum. All right, and I'll come on to that in a bit more detail later on. So we're going to look at, if I just present this screen here, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to, so if I share my screen, so I'm sharing it on a different screen now, so sorry for confusing you. Boom. Hopefully that works. Yeah, beautiful. So we're going to be looking at bond polarity, polar bonds. What does polar bond actually mean? All right, so, okay. So what is electronegativity? It's this whole concept, all right, hopefully. He says, there we go. So it's this concept of electronegativity. All right, so we're going to be looking at what electronegativity is. Now, if you have a look here, there's a definition. Electronegativity is the power of an atom to attract electrons towards itself in a covalent bond. All right, so that's the definition of electronegativity. Okay, so if I just present that, hopefully it won't present on there, which is fine. Okay, so So that's what electronegativity is. Let me just reshare that with you. So it's the power of an atom to attract electrons towards itself in a covalent bond. There we go. All right. So if we think about that hydrogen chloride, yeah. So you can see here, I've got hydrogen and chlorine, and they are sharing a pair of electrons. Okay. Well, don't forget, if you've got the nuclei of each, okay, so you've got the nucleus in the hydrogen atom and the chlorine atom attracting these electrons. All right, so it's a bit like a tug of war. Now, do all atoms have the same pulling power, effectively? Well, no, they don't. That's all electronegativity is. Electronegativity is basically, it's like playing top trumps, all right, for tug of war. Which atoms are best at pulling electrons towards itself in a covalent bond? And every atom, well, most atoms, I should say, on the periodic table does have an electronegativity value. So if you have a look here at this table, it has a value, okay, and it's called the Pauling scale. It's not that important, but all you need to know is this trend. So can you see that it gets more electronegative going that way and more electronegative going that way? So the most electronegative element on the periodic table, just looking for the biggest number there, is fluorine. So in terms of tug of war, top trumps, fluorine is the bestest at attracting electrons towards itself. So why is that, I hear you ask? Okay. So what factors affect it? And there are a couple of trends, all right? So the two yellow arrows are your trends. Do you notice as you go from left to right, they get better at pulling electrons towards themselves? Do you notice as you go from bottom to top, all right, they get better at pulling electrons towards themselves? So I've got to start thinking about, why are the atoms better at pulling electrons towards themselves on the far right of the periodic table and to the top than they are on the left? Okay, so let's have a look here. Well, if we were doing top trumps here, so this is hydrogen versus fluorine. All right, if we go back to the periodic table, can we see hydrogen has a value of 2.1, fluorine has a value of 4.0. So that's got a value of 2.1, that's got a value of 4.0. So in reality, are the electrons, i.e. these two electrons there, okay, shared, are they going to be directly in the middle between those two atoms? Or is one of them going to be pulling the electrons towards itself more strongly, right? Well, based on that, electronegativity top trumps here, fluorine is better at pulling it. So the electrons will actually, if I was drawing out that stick diagram more accurately, okay,
So the electrons are going to be sort of shifted towards the fluorine more. All right, if you have a look at that. Because the fluorine is better at pulling electrons towards itself. It has a higher electronegativity value. Okay? So what factors affect it? All right, nuclear charge, atomic radius, and shielding. Okay, so let's compare two. So if I've got, let's just look at chlorine. We'll look at fluorine and we'll look at carbon. So carbon has a value of 2.5. Fluorine has a value of 4.0. All right, carbon, according to the periodic table, has that symbol. Fluorine has that symbol. So can we see that what's different about them is that the fluorine has a higher atomic number, which is the proton number, isn't it? So, and does that make sense? If it's got more protons in the nucleus, it can attract electrons towards itself more strongly. So the more protons there are, the stronger the attraction. Okay. In terms of size, so again, you want smaller is better, because don't forget, as you go from left to right on the periodic table, all right, as well as electronegativity going up, so this is the scale for electronegativity, it's the same pattern for atomic, well, it's the reverse pattern, if you like, sorry, for atomic radius decreases. The atoms get smaller going from left to right, okay? Okay, so the atoms get smaller. So the smaller the atom, the stronger it can attract, all right, electrons. Okay, bond. Okay, so smaller atoms, stronger attraction. We'll discuss why that is in a moment. And then shielding. What is this concept of shielding? Okay, so if I've got fluorine, so which is 2.7, fluorine. Yeah, so that's 2.7. And then if I've got chlorine, which is 2.87, meow. I'm just gonna show the outer shell here to be a bit lazy and save time. Okay. Can we see that the outer electrons in chlorine are further away from the nucleus? Okay, so can we see, let's just focus on that one and that one. All right, those two are much further away from the nucleus than, the one in chlorine is further away from the nucleus. So you see there, that distance compared with that distance. And because of that, all of the inner shells, so I'm talking about, I'll overwrite them in red now, all of these shells, which will be full, so 2 in the first shell, 8 in the second, are blocking the charge, they're blocking the attraction. They're shielding. It's called shielding. So those full shells in between are shielding the attraction between the nucleus and the outer shell. So based on that, chlorine's nucleus and its outer shell has a weaker attraction than fluorine. And hopefully you can understand that makes sense now, that why fluorine is so good at pulling electrons towards itself is because, look, it's only got one shell. It's got one red circle between the nucleus and the outer shell. Okay? So if you've got more shielding, then the more shells, basically. More shells, more shielding, weaker attraction, worse electronegativity. So as you go down the periodic table, I think I should be able to show you this now. All right. So let's get rid of the arrows. Can we see, as you go down each group, yeah, you're getting more and more shells, yeah? So can you see the numbers are getting smaller because the nucleus is being shielded, it's being protected by those other shells, which prevents it from attracting electrons more easily, okay? Again, nuclear charge, more protons, stronger attraction between the nucleus and the bonding pair of electrons. Atomic radius, smaller is better. So if you've got a smaller atomic radius, it's closer to the nucleus, stronger attraction between the nucleus and bonding pair. And shielding, less shells of electrons between the nucleus and the outer shell means you get stronger attraction. So basically, higher nuclear charge, smaller atomic radius, less shells. That's why fluorine ticks all those boxes. Okay. So as you go down a group, okay, the atoms get bigger, and as they get bigger, you get more shells, so you get more shielding, therefore you get a weaker attraction. So if you have a look at this image here, these are sort of like relative sizes, if you like. So down each group, can we see, so if we just take group one, for example, can we see that the red circles are getting bigger? You go down group two, the red circles are getting bigger, all right? Even there, the red circles are getting bigger, which means the outer shell is getting further away from the nucleus. Therefore, we get more shielding and therefore a weaker attraction between the nucleus and the outer shell. Okay, so across a period, so going down a group, electronegativity decreases because the atoms get bigger, you get more shells, you get a weaker attraction. As you go across a period, so going from left to right, all right, you get more nuclear charge, you get the atomic radius decreases, and you get a stronger attraction. So if we have a look at that trend here. Okay, so get rid of those. As you go from left to right, because as we go from left to right in each row, we're not adding any more shells, all right? So we're getting the same number of shells, but we're adding a proton each time. We're adding a proton to the nucleus, which is positively charged, so it's going to be able to attract its outer shell more. So it's going to go from being, you know, a fairly big atom, add a proton. Oh, it's attracting the outer shell in. Add another proton. It's attracting the outer shell in. You see, each time you add a proton, because we're not adding any more shells, we're just adding a proton and an electron to the same shell, it brings everything in tighter. So you end up with smaller atoms on the far right of the periodic table. So as you go from left to right, electronegativity increases because the atomic radius decreases, i.e. the atoms get smaller. The nuclear charge, i.e. protons in the nuclear charge, just means protons in the nucleus. Okay, because the nucleus is made of protons and neutrons. Neutrons are neutral, therefore have no charge. Protons are positively charged. So they are, every time you add a proton to the nucleus, obviously it becomes more positively charged. And therefore you get a stronger attraction between the nucleus and the bonding pair of electrons. Okay. So here we go. These are two atoms forming a covalent bond. Yeah. And because they're probably the same atom looking at them, can we see that the electrons, when they've overlapped, okay, so I want you to just focus on that area in the middle. Can you see that the electron density, which is the purple cloud, if you like, is in between both of the nuclei, so the two blue circles. So they're sharing equally. So if it was a tug of war, for example, let's go with two carbon atoms. So carbon's there, carbon's there. This one has a pulling power, electronegativity of 2.5. This one has electronegativity of 2.5. So if it'd be the world's dullest tug of war, because they've both got the same pulling power, right? The electrons would be smack bang in the middle, right? Equidistant between both atoms. How exciting, okay? Does that happen in all covalent bonds? No, it does not. So this is where it becomes a little bit more complicated. All right, so you end up with polar covalent bonds. So if we just have a look here at these three images. Here, we've got H bonded to H. They're both the same atom. Yeah, they've both got the same pulling power. Therefore, the electrons in the bond look are smack bang in the middle. It's the same over here. You've got chlorine bonded to chlorine. They've both got the same pulling power. They've got the same electronegativity. So the electrons look are smack bang in the middle. But when you start mixing up atoms with different pulling powers, yeah, so chlorine is 3.0, I think, for example, hydrogen is around 2.1, can we see that chlorine is better at attracting electrons? So the electrons are shifted towards one side. So it's not equidistant. It's not in the middle of the bond, like with the two at the top. It's skewed, okay? It's skewed towards one side, right? It's skewed towards the more electronegative, okay? So here, look, hydrogen and oxygen. Okay, so let me just remind myself of hydrogen and oxygen. So hydrogen is 2.1, oxygen is 3.5. Okay. Okay. So based on that, think about it. Are the two red electrons going to be smack bang in the middle of the covalent bond? Well, just by looking at the electronegativities, can we see that 3.5 is greater than 2.1? So oxygen's better. Oxygen's winning our tug of war. So can you see that? Watch it again. Oxygen has actually attracted the electrons more towards it. Okay. So there we go. If they were the same atom, so two H's or two O's, the electrons would be smack bang in the middle. But because they're different atoms with different pulling powers, it's actually skewed to the right. Now, because of this, all right, we're on our way. Oxygen's on its way to stealing that electron. Okay, and what I mean by that is oxygen's on its way to becoming an ion. All right, so don't forget, an ion is when it has fully gained an electron. Yeah, so this oxide ion, for example, has gained two electrons. Yeah, and the bond has broken. Okay, well, here, can we see that the electron, oxygen is on its way. This oxygen atom here has not fully gained an electron, but it's pulled more closely towards it. So it is becoming negatively charged, all right, but not a full negative charge. So we represent it with these two symbols here. Okay, so again, it's practicing your lowercase Greek deltas. Okay, so it's delta plus, delta minus. Okay. And what that basically means is this is a partial positive charge, and this is a partial negative charge. And what that means is, so a full charge is where it has lost or gained electrons fully. Have these atoms, either the H or the O, lost or gained an electron fully? No, but they're on the way. Okay, so the oxygen is on its way to stealing electrons, which is why it becomes partially negatively charged. All right, whereas here, this one is partially positively charged. So if we compare that to sodium chloride, for example, like we did earlier, you've got Na plus Cl minus. Yeah, so can you see that they've actually become ions? These are full charges, i.e. they have lost or gained electrons. The ones at the top are partial charges because one of the atoms is more electronegative than the other. So it's pulled the electrons towards itself to become partially negatively charged, okay? All right, so you can see here, right? Look at the two, and we call that a polar bond. So that is called a polar bond. So whenever we use these squiggles, all right, we call it a polar bond. Because basically it's a covalent bond, shared pair of electrons, but it is polar, i.e. has a positive end and a negative end. Is it a full positive end? No, it's partially positively charged. Is it a full negative end? No, it's partially negatively charged. All right, but it is still a polar bond. A bit like, you know, the poles of the Earth, you've got North Pole, South Pole, all right? Similar principle. Okay, so if we have a look, here's our non-polar bond. So if it was the same atom, so carbon bonded to carbon, can we see that the electrons, smack bang, in the middle. There's your shared pair of electrons. All right, let's swap that for HCl. Okay, not all the way around, idiot. Oh, no, let's just swap for a fluorine and a carbon. So can we see that the entire purple cloud, which is the electron density around the atoms, has shifted? Yeah, it shifted to the left. So fluorine is pulling the electrons towards it. So this bond here becomes delta negative and delta positive. So the one that's better at pulling electrons, we say, is delta negative, because it's gaining the electrons, it's pulling the electrons, which are negatively charged, towards itself. And the one that's losing the electrons or losing the tug of war is a partial positive charge. Okay? Beautiful. Okay. So again, and the bigger the difference in electronegativity, the greater the tug of war. Okay, so if we have a look here. So here, look, HF, HCl, HBr, HI. They're all polar bonds. So they're all, because there's a difference in electronegativity, yeah, the hydrogen's delta plus, the fluorine's delta minus, the hydrogen's delta plus, the chlorine's delta minus, the hydrogen's delta plus, the bromine's delta minus, and so on and so forth. But are they all the same partial charges in terms of strength? Well, no. You know, it's the bigger the difference, the bigger the polar bond, all right, i.e. the closer they are to becoming full ions. And that's really important, because to say ionic versus covalent, or whether a bond is ionic or covalent, is accurate, but you're talking about opposite ends of the same scale, okay? So what I mean by that is, okay, you've got covalent and you've got ions, okay? And what dictates whether a bond is ionic or covalent? We tell you at GCSE, basically, metal to non-metal, ionic. Non-metal to non-metal, covalent. In reality, it's all to do with the electronegativity difference. So if there is zero difference in electronegativity between two atoms, yeah, so let's go carbon-carbon, for example, then you've got that bond there, okay? So the electrons, can we see, are smack bang in the middle, all right? If there's a small difference in electronegativity, then you end up with, so let's go with HCl, for example. Now, can we see the electrons have shifted towards the right now? So that becomes delta negative, that becomes delta positive. If we have a sort of medium difference, let's call it, in electronegativity, so can we see that this next one, we've still got a covalent bond. Can we still see they're sharing electrons just there? Look, imagine the shell's being drawn, all right? That's delta positive, that's delta negative, all right? So there's a medium difference in electronegativity there, but then if the difference becomes big, so you end up with a big difference in electronegativity, can we see that the atom on the right, this one, is so much more electronegative than the atom on the left, it's pulled the electrons so much towards itself, it stole them, and you end up with ions. So this becomes negatively charged, that becomes positively charged. So you can see that electronegativity dictates whether a bond is covalent or ionic. And loosely, all right, metals to non-metals or non-metals to non-metals works as a general rule. So that's electronegativity, all right? Electronegativity tells you whether or not a bond is going to be ionic or covalent. Big difference in electronegativity, more ionic. Small difference in electronegativity, more covalent. And then you end up with these polar bonds in between. Okay, so these ones here, okay, because they're still covalent. The bond is still intact, but the electrons are skewed towards one atom more than the other. Okay, all right, beautiful. Okay, and this is a sort of, like I say, to achieve, it's a nice graphics, to achieve something which is purely ionic. So 100% ionic, there needs to be an electronegativity difference of 4, okay? So you need something which is electronegative. So fluorine would have to bond with something which is 0, for example, okay? So the greater the difference, can we see this? The bigger the difference in electronegativity, the more ionic bonding we have, okay? Beautiful. Right. Okie dokie. I'm going to exit that now. So now we're coming to the end. Right, and in the Google Classroom for today, I've put down some worksheets for you to all be having a go at. So again, the structure type, they're all GCSE stuff, basically. All right, well, with a bit of new stuff. If you get onto the forces between molecules, that's something that I haven't covered today, all right? Don't worry if you don't get onto that, but you definitely can do the nature of bonds. Okay, so this one here, talking about the types of bond. There's a couple of tasks there for you to have a go at. All right, and some dot and cross diagrams that you need to draw later. So you need to get practicing drawing your dot and cross diagrams. And I'll share the mark schemes to this to the Google Classroom later on today. So you'll see that. So that one page alone is going to keep you busy. We've then got bond polarity, which is electronegativity, which I've just been through. All right. And again, I'll share answers to this with you. Okay. Later on today. And then there is this one here, which is basically, it's a GCSE summary sheet of the different structures. So there are three types of bonding, ionic, covalent, metallic, but there are four types of structure. Giant metallic, well, five types if you count monoatomic. So you've got monatomic, simple molecular, giant covalent, ionic, and metallic. So that's just an information sheet for you to look at. All right, and again, I'll share the answers to all these with you later on. Okay, so if you want to get that done, upload to the classroom, that's great. I'll stick around here for another 5-10 minutes. All right, but if there's no issues, have a wonderful, wonderful day, and I hope you enjoyed your masterclasses.